I've got a whole bunch of these spit rings, which are, well, they're key rings, aren't they? Let me just remind you what they look like, because you get these all over the place. You've got a spit in them. It allows you to insert a key there, but other uses as well. What can you do with them? Well, there's a very advanced bit of mathematics here called the Hopf Fibration. Look at this. How about making one of those with them? My goodness, look at that. Have you ever come across that before? So a friend of mine made one, and then I started copying it and finding the information he sent me is full of heavy, heavy mathematics that I couldn't cope with. But it may be interesting enough to be able to make a copy of it anyway. So here's the first attempt to make this extraordinary piece. I can make it a little more orderly by putting a pen through the middle sometimes to get it so you can see the pattern. And that's almost the limit. You can't do more than that, actually, because where the pen is, there's a small air gap. But the next ring or pair of rings, they come in pairs, you'll see in a minute, will plug it up and you can't do any more. So let's start at the beginning of that one, just to show how simple it is to put together. You start off just with literally a pair of these, like that. And they're actually in the actual model, like that. They're always together, they're not dangling down. They're held at the bottle, and you've got to put another pair through there. So let's have a look. Oh, well, I've got another one. Here we are. That's the next stage, which is a pair of these. So the top pair are interlinked, and the bottom pair are interlinked. So those are linked. And those are linked, that's very important. And then when they're hanging down, they're going to be bunched together like that when they're actually in position. The next stage would be three sets of those. There we are. This is one with three, all pairs. There's three pairs. And again, I'm going to bunch them together like that. And you're starting to, we get that in position. You're starting to see a sort of swirling pattern appearing there. Can you see the swirling pattern? Let's get into focus. The next stage will become a little more clear, because when you put four together, oh yes, or is it six, I've forgotten, you're definitely getting quite a nice little swirl here. To make it a bit more visible, I'll put a pen for it like that. You can definitely see the swirling pattern. And you carry on up the scale. This one here is still not where I was at the beginning. There we are, there's lots more there, there's plenty of room for a few more. So when the last few go in, and it's quite tough to get them to thread these in against the springs, you finally get to the one which I showed at the beginning, which was about the maximum you can get for this size of key ring. And that's that set there with a real swirly pattern to it. It's closing off at the top there, never mind. So it's very difficult to do. It's very difficult to do this because it takes a huge amount of effort to open those rings and close them and pack them together like that so tightly. Let's see if we get the focus again. And I've got to get it to swirl. There we are. So there's something you can do with some of these. But there are a couple of other easier things to do, which that's really quite a tricky one. And this is one of them. It was set by, a Japanese person. You were asked to see if you could get 12 of these rings balanced on a nail. There's the nail. I'll put it on the thing and see how we balance. And the trick was, you're not allowed, you can't just stack them like that, put them in and stack them, because that'd be an easy solution. Anyone could do that. What you've got to do is make sure that every one of the rings, when they are in position, are not touching the ground. Seems impossible, isn't it? Well, here's the clue to it. This is a very clever idea. You just get one ring like that, push the other through, and can you see there's a tiny little air gap there? through that air gap, you're going to push a nail, the nail. Let's see if we can do this without too much fuss. Like that, and there's the basic piece for your. So the point is, when that's full down there, it's not that bottom ring is not touching the base. It's the actual nail head which is touching the base, and you really stack the rings on top of them. Couldn't it be easier? Well, it's a little bit tricky because you've actually got to get the balance right. This is a balancing trick now. If I let that go, it'll fall down. So I've got to start putting a few of these file rings here on this side. Oop, get my key rings onto here. Oops. Let's see if that first lot stacks up. Yes, it does. So you get the idea. You go north, south, east, west, east, west, north, south. And eventually, you fill up the hole in the nail. You can't go more than about 12 because that reaches the top of the nail point. I'll probably stop there, I think. See if I can get that to balance. Oh, no, it hasn't. But I think you've got the idea. Start. The most important thing is to start with that configuration like that, and then you're away, because it's very, very easy thereafter just to put the nail down and start adding rings to it. A little bit off-center. It's more of a balancing act once you've done that, because you've got to get the thing to stay upright, which it does. And I think a total of about 12 for that size of nail can be done. So there's something else to do with key rings. The last one is... something I've only come across, well, as I thought about a few years ago. It's using the key rings, using the file rings, the key rings, I keep using the wrong term, and making them as coins. There's a whole lot of coin tricks which involve having coins like pennies or cents doing various things. And instead of that, you just use these key rings. So this is the earliest one I came across when I was a 12-year-old child, I think it was. I was shown how to do this, which was take that and have it touching two. Take this one I have here, so it's touching two, so it's located, and take that out to form touching two. Can you copy that? What I didn't notice was the grown-up or dad who was showing it to me, when he put it back again and set it up for me to have a go, has set it up the parallelogram with the thing pointing the other way. It's pointing that way now. So when I started going, well, to the left you go touching two. Oh, it's a nice pretty sharpness. But of course it's the wrong way. What I should do, so I've got to reverse everything, mirror, is take the piece out, touching two and touching two. Oh, I've lost myself again. This is what I did with Dad. I've got to go touching two, touching two, and touching two. So something else to do with key rings is treat them as coins, and they're much, much lighter to carry around than coins. And do, well, I've got a book with about several hundred coin tricks you can do, making lines and all sorts of funny games, but do them with key rings, why not? Very versatile thing, these. So get yourself a bag and get making.